So last time we were Yes.
Sir, in last class, you mentioned about a word fermion condensation. So just once, so can you just say about it?
Yeah, fermion condensation is not direct. It's obviously through the pairing
Emergent.
mechanism. It's through the pairing mechanism. So only when the fermions will pair up and show bosonic nature, only then they can condense. Any condensation. Is that okay? Shovik, is that okay?
Yes, sir. Okay.
Yeah, okay. So last time we were discussing the concept of electrons in a box. And this is basically the free electron gas model, free electron Fermi gas model. And we saw that there was a concept of a Fermi surface. Also saw that the Fermi energy is proportional to n to the power 2 by 3, where n is the number. Okay. So in the last class, I implicitly had assumed that we were working at zero temperature. So this is a zero temperature picture. Now, where did I assume zero temperature picture is something that I would like to ask. Is Unnimaya online? Hello? Is Unnimaya online? Okay, she's not online. Fine. Well, anybody can tell me where did we assume that we were working at zero temperature?
So there was no vibration, so the temperature will give rise to vibration, and we assume that there is no potential, so t
Okay.
equals to 0 we assume.
No, Shovik, that is not exactly what I was looking for because, see, remember, we were working in a plain box. There was no lattice, remember? Right? So if there was no lattice, then there is no question of vibrations, isn't it? Sorry, yes, Uttam, you were saying something?
Sir, the highest occupied level was Fermi at 0 Kelvin. So, because there
Okay.
will be any temperature, then more electrons can go higher than the Fermi energy.
So you are saying that there is a sharp division between the occupied and the unoccupied states, correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And at any finite temperature, that sharp division between the occupied and the unoccupied states is not present. Correct?
Yes, sir.
So now that fact
Hello,
is
sir.
actually. Hello?
Sir, I'm Unnimaya. I'm online.
Ah, yes, Unnimaya. So I was just asking
Huh.
that where did we assume the fact that we were working at zero Kelvin? So we've got the answer. So next time I'll ask you. Okay?
Okay, there's a slight network issue, I guess.
No problem, no problem.
Okay,
It's okay,
thank
I
you, sir.
understand. So the zero temperature, the T equal to zero Kelvin, basically arose because there was a sharp distinction between the occupied and the unoccupied states. Sharp distinction between the occupied and the unoccupied states does not exist at any finite temperature. And this fact is expressed mathematically by the Fermi-Dirac distribution function. Okay, so the probability of occupancy of any state is basically given by the Fermi-Dirac distribution function. Is f of e is equal to 1 over this. Okay. Just give me 1 minute. Okay. So now, can somebody tell me how do we derive the Fermi-Dirac distribution function? How do we get this? Anyone?
Sir,
yes.
Sir, from deducing the partition function and applying that, we can fill only two fermions in one step. We can derive.
One second. You said partition function, right? So we take this. Okay. Now, what is the H here for that you're considering?
Actually H is equal to potential energy, kinetic energy plus potential energy.
Okay.
And we assume that the potential energy is mu times of total mu times mu into N, and that is chemical potential, we say.
Okay. So yeah, that's not very precise. You're almost right. Okay. The kinetic energy part is correct. Now I'll come to that. But the potential energy part is not exactly minus mu times N. Okay. What you're talking about actually is the grand canonical picture. Of working in the canonical picture, we actually work in the grand canonical picture where we say this is e to the power minus beta H minus mu N. Okay. And there mu is the chemical potential. So it's not exactly potential energy, okay, in the sense of having interactions between electrons or the potential energy of the electrons due to the interaction with the ions. It's not any of those. It's a chemical potential, and that's different from a potential energy. Now let's come back to the kinetic energy. So what is kinetic energy here? What do I take kinetic energy is the what do I take for the kinetic energy part of the Hamiltonian? Yeah?
P squared by 2m summation over all the
states. P squared by 2m. So, now if I take P squared by 2m, then what do I do for the trace? So, how do I take the trace? Is it an integral over the momenta? Should I do that or should I do something else? Is the trace equal to the integral over the momenta? Is this what I should do?
So we can.
Can you repeat that? Sorry, I lost.
P square average.
Sorry, can you repeat that?
And take P square average, which is the trace of the density and the average of P square.
How do you take the? So you're saying take the average of P squared, correct?
Yes, sir.
Huh? Yeah, so but how do you take the average of P squared? You have to do it as trace of P squared e to the power minus beta H divided by trace of e to the power minus beta H, correct? The question is, how do I take the trace? That is the trace equivalent to doing an integral over the momenta? Is this correct or not? Anyone? Is this correct? Have all of you had your coffee, tea and snacks? Please tell me, is this trace formula correct or not? Nobody's saying. So this trace formula, if I assume, it means that I am assuming that we are doing a classical trace. This is correct only for classical stat mech. Okay. In quantum stat mech, the trace becomes a trace over the energy eigenstates. And we saw all the Schrodinger's problem, the Schrodinger's equation for particle in a box problem in the previous class. The energies, the EKs, right, were h cross squared by 2m, kx squared plus ky squared plus kz squared. And the states of the system was defined by psi by kz of r, right? So basically one has to take the trace over these, and trace basically means you take psi, okay, and then e to the power minus beta h psi, right? So if you do that, then you would see that this Hamiltonian is basically sum over ek nk, where nk is the number of states, number of electrons in the momentum state k, and ek is the energy corresponding to the state k, and this is an operator basically. So when you go to if you are doing quantum stat mech, then the trace is actually a much more complicated object, okay, taken over something called coherent states, right? And this n operator, this occupancy operator, turns out to be equal to ck dagger ck, where these are second quantized operators. Let me not go into that. There is also a simpler way to derive this, and if anybody wants to know, please get back to me later, I will tell you, okay? But for this class, let's just assume that we know that the probability of occupancy of a state is given by the Fermi-Dirac distribution function, and that is just f of e is e to the power beta e minus mu plus 1, right? And sorry, I removed the beta also. Okay, so then beta here is 1 over kBT. So Unimaya, can you tell me what is the significance of this mu? What does it give you? Nimaya, can you hear me? Network seems to be bad. Fine. So, can somebody tell me what is the significance of the chemical potential?
Sir, this is Fermi energy at T equal to 0 Kelvin. This is equal to chemical potential.
Okay. So, one significance is that this becomes equal to the Fermi energy at T equal to 0. But in general, mu is a function of temperature. Absolutely right. So mu is in general a function of temperature, but if I take mu of T equal to 0, then that turns out to be exactly equal to the Fermi energy. That by looking at this Fermi Dirac distribution function as a function of energy for various different temperatures. So suppose we plot this Fermi function as a function of energy, okay? And let's assume that the mu is fixed and the temperature is fixed, right? So the temperature being fixed means beta is fixed, okay? So if the E is, let's say, zero, is zero, then we will get on this axis 1 over e to the power minus mu by kBT plus 1, okay? And if the temperature is, or if the thermal energy scale is much smaller than the chemical potential, then this number e to the power minus mu by kT is an extremely small number, right? Because mu by kBT is much greater than 1, then e to the power minus mu by kBT is like 0, and you would be approaching 1. This is for e equal to 0. Now exactly at e equal to mu, what happens? At exactly e equal to mu, this Fermi function becomes exactly equal to half. And when E becomes extremely large, is that E to the power beta E would be extremely large, hence 1 over infinity would be 0. So this would approach 0. Right? So one sees that this is actually given by something like this. Okay? And if you decrease the temperature, it's easy to see that this becomes sharper. Exactly T equal to 0. And what does this step function mean? It exactly means that there is a sharp distinction between states which have f of e equal to 1, and for the unoccupied states which are greater than the chemical potential or the Fermi energy, you will get zero occupancy, right? So these are unoccupied states and these are occupied states. But then what we see is that at any finite temperature, even very high energy states have a finite probability to be occupied. Energy states have a probability to be unoccupied also. Okay, so that's what happens at finite temperature. And this Fermi Dirac distribution function is a very important quantity, because as we will see, it determines or it changes the qualitative behavior of the specific heat and susceptibility and so on. Okay, and this restriction of the Pauli's exclusion principle is actually a very, very strong restriction. See in the next few slides. Okay, so we had seen the Fermi gas at 0 Kelvin, and now let's start seeing the properties of the Fermi gas at finite temperature. Consider is what happens to the specific heat, right? And we had done this for phonons also, so let's do this for electrons. Okay, so specific heat of a free Fermi gas okay. So, Unnimaya, if you come online, please let me know. I mean, I see you online, but I guess your network is not good enough to connect properly. So, meanwhile, is Rishikesh online?
Sir.
Unnimaya, you are online. Okay. So, how can finding the specific heat of a free Fermi gas? On the same lines as we did for phonons.
Okay, so like if we supply heat, the electrons actually and temperature
very good
increases.
Mm-hmm.
I think we can calculate the.
Okay, good. So yeah. Be online. Okay, I will follow your line of argument and let's just derive the specific heat. Okay. You're saying is let's say there are n electrons in a system. Okay.
Okay.
And if we supply a certain amount of heat, right, then basically that there will be a certain raise in the temperature of the system. Correct.
Yes.
So the heat has gone into raising the temperature of the system. Correct.
Yes.
Is this correct? Okay. So then, but since this is a free Fermi gas, there is no potential energy for the system, correct?
Yes.
Which means that the entire heat has gone into changing only the internal energy.
Yeah.
That's correct, right?
Yes.
Okay. So what does this give you for the specific heat then? So from this, what do we derive as the specific heat?
I think we can calculate the change in internal energy and find it.
Can you speak a little bit loudly? I'm not able to hear.
Sir, am I audible?
Yeah, now you're audible.
So I think we can find the internal energy or something like that.
So you see, this is du by dt, right? So from this, what do you get for the du by dt? You get just N, right?
N, yeah.
In fact, the units are not completely right. There should be thermal energy here. Okay, N times KB delta T. And so you will get N times KB.
NKB.
Correct? So this will be basically the number of mole times the universal gas constant.
Okay.
The significant here is that the specific heat turns out to be a constant temperature. No matter what temperature you are, the specific heat turns out to be a constant.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So, but what has been experimentally found is that the specific heat as a function of temperature actually is a linear function. Okay. It's actually linear.
Yeah.
The electronic contribution. In fact, we ask this question in interviews, right? What is the specific heat of a metal look like? Yes, it's basically, there are two parts to it. One is a linear part and one is a cubic part. This comes from the electrons and this comes from the lattice vibrations or the phonons. Yeah. And this we had seen last time.
Yeah.
When we did phonons, right?
Yes.
So now the question is, what is the flaw in this argument? So this argument is flawed, right?
Yeah.
Where is the flaw?
So you have calculated it classically, but you have not taken the Fermi-Dirac distribution into the picture.
I agree with that. So now the question is, where should I take the Fermi-Dirac distribution into account?
So and you have to calculate the average energy Dirac distribution.
Very good. Okay. Yeah. So that's a sophisticated argument. I agree with that. Okay. But suppose I want to change this simplistic argument. Okay. Now, where exactly should I change it so that I get the qualitative answer? So, the answer that you gave was, so who was that? Sorry, I couldn't recognize the voice. Who was that?
No, Gautam, sir.
Gautam. Gautam. So, you're basically saying that let's find out again the average energy, correct? And that yes, average energy is basically the internal energy, and that's where we would do an integral over the density of states, the Fermi-Dirac distribution function, and so on. Very good.
Yes,
so that's the precise way to do this for a free Fermi gas. The question I'm asking is, if we restrict ourselves to this simple level, modify this argument in some way so that we get the right answer. Anyone?
Sir?
Yes?
Sir, here we assume that all the electrons have the same amount of temperature change, but all the electrons cannot be treated in same way because there are so many energy levels and there is certain, all the energy levels have a finite probability of occupancy. Okay. So we should multiply something within each term and then calculate.
So you are going in the right direction and you are not completely precise. Can you make your argument more precise? So what I'm saying is, you are right that we have taken a classical picture. I've assumed that all the electrons in the system, if there are n electrons in the system, all electrons in the system are absorbing that heat. Heat is basically kb times delta t.
Oh,
so that's the assumption. Yes.
Only a small fraction of electrons who are closer to the Fermi level, they absorb the heat. Not
that's
all the electrons.
Right. So the argument has to be modified here. This is where the modification lies. Right. So this n has to be this n bar is a fraction of the electrons which are lying very close to the Fermi level. Only those can absorb the heat. Now, where does that argument come from? That is a correct argument, but why should that argument be correct? All the electrons absorb the heat.
There is Pauli exclusion principle working in the background.
Correct.
So when we are giving some energy to the system, then all the electrons will not be able to cross the barrier.
Where is the barrier here? So this is the Fermi-Dirac distribution function, right?
Just consider the to 0 Kelvin. Then let's say we are increasing the temperature.
Okay.
Then the electrons which are far below the energy level described by that mu will not be able to get enough energy, they will not be able to go beyond the mu level.
Exactly. Okay, good. So I understand what you're saying. See, basically what you're trying to say is that suppose I consider an electron which is sitting here, right? This is far below the chemical potential. Now, if I supply this electron some heat, right, then it has to be able to make a transition to a state which is here.
Yes.
But then and the state is already occupied.
That state is also occupied. Yes.
Already occupied. So which means the probability, even at finite temperature, of this electron making a transition to this state is extremely, extremely small. If we consider these electrons, which are in the vicinity of the Fermi level or in the vicinity of the chemical potential, then they have the largest probability of making those transitions.
Yes.
Turns out that the width of this, the order KBT. Of 4 KBT. Yeah. What this is telling us is that all the electrons in the system will not be able to absorb the heat at all. Right. Only the electrons which are in the vicinity of the chemical potential, in fact, in around 4 KBT of the Fermi level, only those can actually absorb the heat. Right. So which means the N has to be modified to some N bar, which is 4 KBT epsilon F. This is the fraction, right, times the total N. Okay. And if we take this and substitute this back, then we would get delta U by delta T is N bar KB, which is equal to 4 KB N by EF times T. Okay. So this tells us that CB is proportional to temperature. So this is the qualitative argument which tells us that the specific heat is actually proportional to the temperature for electrons. Okay. So this is what you should remember, right? The formal argument will follow. In the next slide, we will do the full formal argument. But the qualitative argument for why the specific heat is linear with temperature is because not all the electrons in the system can absorb the heat. Electrons, fine, they're all moving around in the system. And on the face of it, they all appear to be exactly equivalent to each other. But remember that these electrons are actually occupying energy levels according to the Pauli's exclusion principle. Space they appear completely equivalent and moving around independent of each other. Energy wise they are very, very distinct, and only the electrons which are within 4 KBT of the chemical potential will be able to absorb the heat. The specific heat will be proportional to the temperature. Okay. 4 KBT come from do is you can draw the Fermi Dirac distribution function and then take a tangent here. Okay. And if you draw the tangent and see where it cuts here, it turns out that this is actually twice of KBT. This length is twice of KBT and this is around twice of KBT. Okay. So basically the tangent cuts the f of e equal to 1 and f of e equal to 0 at 2 KBT and mu minus 2 KBT and mu plus 2 KBT. That's why the width is 4 KBT. So in fact, in the next slide, when we do the formal argument, it will be important for us to understand what does the derivative of the Fermi energy look like. Let's take a look at the derivative of the Fermi energy as well. So this is Hello. Df by dE. Yeah.
Sir, what is the rough argument we propose to get the N bar?
What is the
argument to derive N bar?
What is the argument? Okay. Sure, sure. See, basically, what we are saying is suppose you go to an energy which is far below the Fermi level. Okay, so first of all, where does the capital N come from in this classical argument? This capital N comes from the fact that we have N free valence electrons in the system. Okay. And and there was no Pauli's exclusion principle, then each electron would be able to absorb some heat. Okay. And that is what gives you the, that is equivalent to saying that there is an equipartition theorem in the system. Classical result, which is that the specific heat is a constant. In the Fermi gas, we know that if we, sorry, Yes, Krishna, did you understand?
Yeah, yes, sir, I'm following.
Yeah, you're following, right? Okay. So now if we go to a energy scale, which is much smaller than the chemical potential, supply the system a small amount of heat, then you see that the electron has to make a transition to a higher energy level, but already that higher energy level could be occupied. There is a very high chance that it would be already occupied, which means that this electron cannot make the transition. Okay, so basically what is happening is that, you know, it's as if there is a series of filled levels, right? And only the levels which are close to the unfilled levels will be able to make the transition. See, if all the levels are unfilled, there is no point. They are already unfilled, there are no electrons there to absorb the heat. If all the levels are filled, then they have to make a transition to an unfilled level, okay, to an unoccupied level. So only those electrons which are in the vicinity of the chemical potential, which have access to these unfilled levels, right, only they will be able to make the transition. That is basically the idea. So that is why you have to have only the fraction of the electrons within KBT of Fermi level which can absorb the heat. Is that argument clear now?
Question was that for N bar, we have divided 4 KBT by epsilon F. That fraction is...
Okay. So, see, the idea is that it has to be a fraction, okay? And KBT is an energy scale. And what is that energy scale being compared to? And the characteristic energy scale of the metal is basically the Fermi energy. So, remember, I mean, we did not actually calculate this, but I just mentioned that the Fermi energy in metals is of the order of 10 to the power 5 Kelvin, okay? So, this is again something that all of you should remember, that the Fermi energy is actually a huge scale. Okay, it's about 10 to the power 5 Kelvin, so which means 10,000 Kelvin, right? So it's a very, very large energy scale. And we know that we can almost never reach this energy scale. I mean, the metal and everything would basically vaporize before we reach this energy scale. But it turns out that even though this energy scale is so large, there are a lot of things that are actually determined, okay, even at 300 Kelvin, by this energy scale. Not only that, it turns out that although we can't access these temperatures of 10 to the power 5 Kelvin, we can access these energy scales, and in fact much higher energy scales, if we look at spectroscopy. Spectroscopy, we can actually access the Fermi energy and many other, even unoccupied scales, we can go beyond the Fermi energy and so on. Okay. Now, what I'm saying is that if we want the fraction of the electrons, the chemical potential, that fraction has to be the thermal energy divided by the characteristic energy scale of the system. Okay. So, Krishna, that is the hand-waving argument. If you want the more precise argument, what you have to do is... Yeah, the precise argument would be that you calculate the area under this curve in the vicinity of the Fermi level. Okay, so you take the Fermi Dirac distribution function and then you calculate what is the area under the curve. What you would see is that is actually proportional to 4 kBT by EF. Okay?
Okay.
See, the total, if you do the full integral, what you should be getting is full N, okay? But the area under the curve only for this part should turn out to be just 4 kBT by EF times N. That's the argument, okay?
Okay, yeah.
And again, you have to use there something called a Sommerfeld expansion, because the Fermi Dirac distribution function might not give you analytical answers easily, okay? But you can see certain, you can make certain approximations and get this answer.
Yeah, it's fine. Thank you.
Yeah. So, so now let's look at what does.
Sir, I have a question.
Yeah. Yes.
Very low temperature, the electronic contribution to the specific heat is greater than the phononic contribution to the specific heat.
That's correct.
What is the reason behind this?
The reason is basically the distribution function. So the way distribution function works is that you get the Bose-Einstein distribution function for these for the phonons, and you get the Fermi-Dirac distribution function for the electrons. Okay, and it's simply that there are more number of electrons at low enough temperatures which can absorb the heat. But then you remember the characteristic energy scale of phonons is the Debye energy scale. Okay, at least for the acoustic phonons. And the Debye energy scale, so if I write the Debye energy scale, that is of the order of 10 to the power 2 to 10 to the power 3 Kelvin. Okay, so 100 to 1000 Kelvin. So roughly about 400 Kelvin, let's say. So what yes. what we are saying is that at very low temperature, the distribution functions, the quantum distribution functions, they restrict or they produce a constraint in such a way that more number of electrons are able to absorb the heat than the phonons. But as we go closer and closer to the characteristic energy scales of one of the subsystems, whether it is electrons or phonons, we see that all the phonons are now participating. So as we increase the temperature and reach the Debye energy scale, then more and more number of phonons will start participating. And in fact, you can show that at some scale, these two will actually cross. Okay, the electronic specific heat and the phononic specific heat will actually cross. Okay, and the simple reason is that as the Debye energy scale is reached, almost all the acoustic phonons in the system will start participating. But the electrons, since even 300 Kelvin is much smaller than the Fermi energy scale, the fraction, the thermal energy divided by the Fermi energy, is still a very small number. Okay, so basically that is the explanation. Does that satisfy you?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So if you look at the derivative of the Fermi function, then the derivative for energies which are much smaller compared to the chemical potential, here the Fermi function is basically flat, right? Which means that the derivative will be basically zero. Now, near the chemical potential is where all the action happens. But what happens for energies much larger than the chemical potential? Again, the Fermi function is flat, which means that the derivative will be zero. Okay. But then what happens here? Let me say that this is minus of df by dE, and you will see the reason. Okay. So here we see that the derivative starts to become negative, right? And it's negative, and it's large and negative, right? And then again that negative number becomes smaller and smaller and smaller and reaches zero. Is that the magnitude of the derivative or minus of the derivative increases, reaches a certain maximum, and then decreases once again. So the Fermi function actually looks like a highly peaked function. Okay, and the peak is exactly at the chemical potential. And it turns out that the width of this derivative is actually 4 kBT. Okay, this 4 is not an exact number. Okay, you can actually write down the derivative of the Fermi function. You can calculate this analytically and calculate the full width at half maximum. So it's a number of the order of 4 to 5, right? And there is no need to debate about that number. If you take 5, if you take 6, doesn't matter. Okay, you will get exactly the same qualitative results. But basically the idea is that the width of the Fermi function is of the order of the thermal energy scale. And this fact is actually going to be very important in the specific heat analysis, right? So just remember this, that the derivative of the Fermi function, in fact, if you calculate this with respect to the energy or with respect to the temperature, as we will see in the next slide, will turn out to be equivalent and will be proportional to the thermal energy scale. The width will be proportional to the thermal energy scale, okay? So any doubts so far? No? Okay, so now let's follow the full formal procedure, which is to calculate the expectation value of the energy. Okay, and to calculate the expectation value of the energy, what we have to do is, we have to do this, right? So the Hamiltonian is basically Ek times Nk, sum over all k states. Now, there is a small thing that I have left out here, okay, which is basically the spin of the electrons, right? So I should be summing over the spin of the electrons also. And what we are saying here is that the energy of the electron in the state K and with spin sigma is the same for both the sigmas, okay? So Ek for spin half, for spin plus half, is equal to the Ek for spin minus half. So can somebody tell me when is this condition satisfied? Or when is this condition violated, for example?
When we apply a magnetic field, external magnetic field, then the energy will
Exactly. So as soon as we apply a magnetic field, time reversal symmetry is broken and there will be a Zeeman splitting between the upspin and the downspin. Correct? And that's when you would add an epsilon k minus mu times h or plus mu times h, and the two bands. So if we draw the two bands, the conventional way to draw the two bands is like this. So we draw Ek versus k. So this is Ek versus k, right? And then we say that we say this, right? This is how it is conventionally drawn. This is the spin up and this is spin down. But tell me something. Does it mean that all k less than 0 are spin up and all k greater than 0 are spin down? Are spin up? Is this picture actually correct?
No.
No, right? So what should I do? So how do I take this forward? This is for both spins, right? This is for plus minus half. So what should happen? How should I draw this when I apply a magnetic field? So this, as you said, is incorrect. This is not the correct picture, correct? So, okay, let me tell you the answer. The what I should be doing is I should be doing this and I should draw two pictures, okay? And this. So this is for spin up and this is for spin down, right? And then what I should do is I should draw the same Fermi level. And now what you can see is that the total number of electrons with spin down is less than the total number of electrons with spin up. And that would mean that the magnetization in the system, which is this minus this, is not equal to zero. Okay. So applying a magnetic field will basically polarize the spins. So good, but that is for magnetic field. But now we are not considering the application of a magnetic field. And in the absence of a magnetic field, we only have epsilon k. So now, what is the expectation value of nk sigma? What is the average occupancy or what is the average probability of a certain state being occupied? That is given by the Fermi-Dirac distribution function. So that is e to the power beta ek minus mu plus 1, where beta is 1 over kBT. Alright, so if we now take this and substitute this back, we would get U is equal to sum over k sigma epsilon k e to the power beta ek minus mu plus 1. And now we do the standard trick as we did for the phonons also. This sum over k, first of all, let's consider the sum over sigma. Okay. Now you can see that inside this, the argument does not have the spin at all. Right? So the sum over sigma can be done trivially and you would just get a 2 outside, and the sum over k will be written as sum over k epsilon k over e to the power beta e epsilon k minus mu plus 1. Okay. And now the sum over k can be converted to a density of states integral. So this gives us d of e divided by e to the power beta e minus mu plus 1. Does everybody know how to do this conversion? If somebody doesn't know, please let me know, because this is an important step.
No, sir, I don't know. Can you please explain?
Sure. Okay. What's your name?
Suhas.
Suhas. Okay. Yeah. So, Suhas, let's go through this. So what we are saying is that the sum over k of some function of ek can be written as an integral first of all over the momentum. Clear to you how to do this? This is okay, right? The sum over k can be converted to an integral where the integral is the dk, the infinitesimal volume element, divided by the actual volume element in the Brillouin zone.
Yes, sir.
Is this okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. So this gives us v by 2 pi whole cube, okay, integral dk times f of ek. Okay. Now what we will do is we will insert here a delta function. Okay. So how do we do that? We say that there is a delta of e minus ek integral over dE. Now you will see why we inserted this. The reason we inserted this is because, remember, the density of states is actually given by integral dk v by 2 pi whole cube delta of e minus ek. Okay, so this is the density of states, remember, right?
Sir.
So yes, you can see that there is that form that is appearing here. Okay, so what I will do is I will insert this, and remember, this is just one, because if I integrate the delta function, I'll just get one. Okay, so I've not changed anything here by inserting this integral. This is just multiplying it by one. Okay, and now I will interchange these two integrals, the energy integral and the k integral. And if I do that and take this entire v by 2 pi whole cube inside, I will get integral, okay, of delta E, delta of E minus EK, and then v by 2 pi whole cube. I'm sorry, I've made a small mistake. Just give me one moment. Yeah. So integral over dE, then integral over dk, v by 2 pi whole cube, and f of ek, delta of e minus ek. Okay, so now Suhas, can you tell me what will be the result of this integral here?
We have to substitute ek in the function.
E, right?
Yeah.
So wherever there is a ek here, we can substitute the e, correct?
Yes.
Yeah, good. So which means that when I substitute with e here, then this will go outside this integral?
Yes, sir.
Because there is no k in that?
Yes, sir.
Right? So this becomes integral dE f of e times v by 2 pi whole cube integral dk times delta of e minus ek. Okay? And this you can see density of states here. Okay? So that's why what we did here was take this sum over k, okay, and then first convert this to an integral over k, and then convert this to a density of states integral. Is this argument clear now? Okay. Yeah?
Thank you, sir.
Sure. Was there any other question? No? Okay. So, so now we have to analyze this particular integral, okay? So let me just erase this. Okay. Now let's write this u is equal to twice integral dE times dE divided by this. All right. So I can see here that there is a e minus mu. Integral over dE goes from 0 to infinity for a free Fermi gas. Okay, because remember the E is just h cross squared k squared by 2m. So it's just positive and it can go all the way from 0 to infinity. Okay, So which means that now I can I want to do a substitution of E minus mu, but then to do that I have to add D of E and then E minus mu divided by E to the power beta E minus mu plus 1 times integral, there is a 2 here, 0 to infinity D of E divided by E to the power beta E minus mu plus 1. Okay, now for finding the specific heat, we would have to take the du by dt. Okay, and when I take the derivative with respect to temperature, then I would be taking the derivative of the first part and of the second part. Okay, and I'm claiming that the second part derivative will actually be zero. Okay, now can somebody tell me why that would be zero? Or why that would not be zero? Anything. So essentially what I am asking you is this: dE times D of E times F of E, where F of E is the Fermi Dirac distribution function, 0 to infinity. If I take this derivative, I am claiming that this derivative is zero. The question is why? Anyone? Why is this derivative zero? What does that integral represent?
Sir, that is represented. Yes.
Go on, go on. Both of you. It's fine.
The total number of states are constant, not dependent on temperature.
Total number of states? Is it the total number of
particles?
Yes. Because what we are doing here is we are taking the density of states. We are multiplying it by the Fermi Dirac distribution function and integrating it from 0 to infinity. Looking at which are the states which are occupied, right? Or the occupancy of each state. So if we had done this at zero temperature, for example, okay, just to understand this, then all the states below the Fermi level would contribute one here, which means we are just integrating all the number of states which are occupied, okay, and that would give us a total number of electrons. But then even at finite temperature, the total number of electrons is not changing, okay. So because the total number of electrons is not changing, the dN by dt is basically zero, okay. So this integral here is just the total number of electrons. N is the number of electrons in the system. And the average number of electrons in the system does not change. Okay, so remember, we in deriving the Fermi Dirac distribution function, we have to choose a grand canonical ensemble, which means that the subsystem that we are considering for deriving this is actually in equilibrium with a reservoir. But that equilibrium means that there is an energy exchange as well as a particle exchange. Okay, but the particle exchange doesn't mean that there is a gain or a loss. Equilibrium means that the average number of particles in the system is still constant. Okay, so that's very crucial to remember. So the N here is the average number of electrons, and that is a constant as a function of temperature and change. So which means that the dN by dt is zero, and this term will not contribute to the temperature derivative. Okay. But remember, there is a mu here. Okay, now the mu, okay, but it turns out it is actually peak function of temperature. Now showing this all, okay, it's a weak function of temperature. And how do we show this? Okay, if you want to show this, you have to take this integral, okay, this dN by dt equal to zero. And then here, when you do this integral, you will basically get dE times the density of states times the dF of E by dt equal to zero, from zero to infinity. And now remember, when you take the derivative with respect to the Fermi function, there will be two parts. Okay, the Fermi function has a chemical potential and explicitly the temperature as well. So when you take the derivative of the Fermi function with respect to the temperature, you will get a d mu by dt also, but you will also take an explicit derivative with respect to this temperature. Okay, but this derivative of the chemical potential is something that you can find out by using this condition. Okay, and if you do that, then you will see that the mu of t is actually mu of zero, which is just the Fermi level, minus a small number times t by epsilon f whole squared. Okay, and if you are at temperatures which are of the order of 300 Kelvin and epsilon f is of the order of 10 to the power 5 Kelvin, then the chemical potential is hardly dependent on temperature. Okay, so it's a very weak function of temperature, and to a first approximation we can neglect the temperature dependence of the chemical potential and say that the mu of t is basically equal to the mu of zero, which is just the Fermi level. This is an approximation that we will be making here in order to derive the specific heat. Okay, so given this, let's now go back to this expression. And neglect the part which is independent of temperature. So basically this becomes equal to plus 2 mu n. Okay? And du by dt, if we do this, then we would get a d by dt of this infinity dE times e minus mu over plus zero. Okay, so the derivative acts only on the first term. All right, now the fact that this function here, which is the derivative of the Fermi function, when we take the d by dt, it will only act on this. So this is just the derivative of the Fermi function. Fermi function was a very was a highly peaked function. Okay, now a highly peaked function actually has a significance. So what we are saying is that the df by dt is a highly peaked function, and if you multiply any normal regular function with this, okay, then you can see that if, let's say, this is the density of states and this is df by dt as a function of E, then you can see that wherever the Fermi function, wherever this derivative is zero, the product of these two will basically give you zero. Okay, and only where the derivative is non-zero, that is where the derivative will actually multiply this, and you will pick up this d of e only around that value. Okay, in other words, what you will see is that the df by dt is actually proportional to delta of e minus ef. Okay, which means that when you do the integral over d of e, then you will basically pick up the d at the ef itself. Okay, so integral d of e times df by dt will be proportional to d of ef. Okay, now how do we see this, right? So let's take the Fermi function and take the derivative df by dt. Okay, so this is d by dt of e to the power this is 1 over e to the power e minus mu by kbt plus 1. So this is some algebra, so please bear with me. We'll just do this algebra and then see what comes out. Okay, so this is just d by dt of minus 1 over e to the power e minus mu by kbt plus 1 whole squared times d by dt of e to the power e minus mu by kbt. Okay, so this will give us minus of Fermi function whole squared. This is just f squared, right? And then the derivative of this will just give us e to the power e minus mu by kbt, okay, times the 1 over minus 1 over kbt squared times e minus mu. Excuse me. Now there is I have written it as 1 over kbt squared, but there is actually a factor of kb also, because 1 over kb will not contribute. So I can write this as minus kb times this. So then if I then substitute this here, you will see that I get an e minus mu whole squared. Okay.
Sir, I think I am messing up something. Can you just tell me something, that the derivative of the distribution with temperature with integration density of states gives us zero, and when we derivative the epsilon minus nu multiplied by that Fermi function, it is non-zero. Then in the last case, which, why we are saying that del f del t is delta function?
So that we have not come to. That is what we are showing now. Yeah, I have not shown it. Okay. I have not proved that.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Okay.
So.
Okay.
Yeah. See, basically, I will first give you a zero temperature argument. Okay. Zero temperature argument is really simple. So,
its value will be 1 below E equal to mu.
E less than equal to EF, and it is 0.
0. Or, E greater than EF.
Correct? Yeah, E greater than EF. And in fact, it is actually half at E equal to EF.
Yes.
The other ones, right? So now, how can I represent this function? So can I represent this function as a step function?
Can we represent it as a step function?
Yeah, it can be, right?
Yes.
So basically then f of e is given by theta function of e f minus e. Correct?
Yes.
So whenever E is greater than EF, this will become negative and I will get a 0. Then EF, this will become positive and I will get 1. Okay. And the theta function here, there are two kinds of theta functions. In one theta function, the function is completely, the function is discontinuous and the value can be defined either as 1 or 0 exactly at the EF. In another kind of theta function, you can define it as half. Okay, the function is still discontinuous, but the function value is the average of the two values. If I take the derivative of this,
it will give me delta function.
I will get the delta function. Okay, minus delta of EF minus E. Okay, so the theta function derivative is basically a delta function. So you can see that at zero temperature, it's exactly a delta function, right? But then what I've done here is a derivative not with respect to temperature, but with respect to the energy. Okay, so that's a subtle thing, correct? So if I want to do the same thing here, I have to and do
when we find the derivative with respect to temperature, we derive that the chemical potential at a non-zero temperature from this relation, then how can we say that this is a delta function if it is not zero?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that? Can you repeat what you asked? I couldn't understand.
We have found out that the chemical potential at a non-zero temperature can be represented as a chemical potential at zero minus some temperature T by Tf squared. And it is followed by the time derivative of distribution function. Temperature derivative is total multiplied by an integration is zero. Then from an equation left hand side to right hand side zero, then how can we show that it is a delta function later?
No. So right hand side was not zero actually. So what you're asking is that, so suppose I write n as integral dE f of e times d of e. That's what you're saying, right? Isn't this what you're saying?
Yes, sir.
That if I now take the derivative, I will get a zero here. Okay. Now on the right hand side, I actually get two terms. Okay. The one of the terms, there will be an explicit derivative of the temperature. In the other one, there will be an implicit derivative of the temperature because that derivative depends on the chemical potential. So in one of the terms, you will get a dmu by dt. In the other term, you will not get a dmu by dt. That's all what I'm saying. Okay, now from this you can actually derive what is the form of the dU by dT such that the total number is invariant with respect to temperature. And from here you can derive that the mu of T is mu of 0 minus T squared by epsilon F squared with some coefficient. So I did not do this derivation, right? I just stated this result. You understand? I just stated this result, but you can find this result by doing this algebra. Okay? But what I said from here was that you can assume that the mu is a very weak function of temperature.
And hello, sir.
Yeah.
There is some disturbance.
Yeah, actually, can you mute yourself, Shovik? Basically, the chemical potential is just a weak function of temperature, and I just stated it. I did not derive it. Okay, it's a laborious derivation, so I did not go into that. Is that okay?
Okay, sir.
So now what we are doing is we are taking the derivative of the Fermi function with respect to temperature. So let's just define it as df by dx times dx by dt by using the chain rule, and d by dx of e to the power x plus 1 inverse times dx by dt, and dx by this, then I would get e my and d by dt only of 1 over t. Okay, so that would give me minus e to the power x by e to the power x plus 1 whole square. Okay, and then e minus mu by kbt kb times minus 1 over t squared.
There will be always a temperature dependence of chemical potential.
Exactly, that's what I'm saying, that there will be a derivative with respect to temperature of the chemical potential also. At weak, there is a very weak potential on the temperature, hence we are dropping it to a first approximation. Okay, and if you take that the chemical potential's dependence on the temperature also, you will not change the result qualitatively. Okay, that can be also shown. In fact, I have the
formula, okay,
and I will put this up on the drive folder. You can just take a look at that.
Okay, sir.
Okay, yeah. So what you see here is that this is actually given by e to the power x by e to the power x plus 1 whole squared times e minus mu by kb t squared, okay, where this x is basically e minus mu by kbt. Okay, just give me one moment.
Sir, please don't erase. Hello?
Yeah, I didn't erase, sorry.
Okay.
Yeah, so basically what you see is that you can convert this temperature integral into an energy integral by doing this substitution, okay, and then you can see that you are again going to get a delta function. In fact, the other way to see this is that if you take this e minus mu by kbt, this is this e to the power x by e to the power x plus 1 whole squared is just a product of two different functions. I'm sorry, this sketchboard is basically limited, okay. So e to the power x by e to the power x plus 1 whole squared is just 1 over e to the power x plus 1 and multiplied by e to the power minus x plus 1. Okay, so if you take the product of these two, the 1 over e to the power x plus 1 looks like this, and the 1 over e to the power minus x plus 1 looks like this. Okay, so if you take the product of these two, then for x which is large and negative, you will see that the product of these two will give you 0. The product of these two will give you 0 at large x. Only when the x is close to 0 which means that the E is close to the chemical potential, that is when it will be non-zero. Okay, so this part is non-zero only when the E is close to mu. Okay, and this 1 over T squared, as T tends to 0, is basically going to blow up. Okay, and the delta function. Okay, so can I erase now?
Okay, yes, sir.
Okay. Sorry, I usually do this in Seminar Hall 3 in JNC, and there is a large board there. So it's very easy because one can, you know, keep all the parts of the board. But unfortunately here, that is not possible. So we have to, please bear with me for this. Okay. Okay. Yeah. So if I now substitute this entire thing here, then I would get this expression. So let me just take this from the textbook. This is derived here. So you can see this derivation in this book by Ipak and Luth. Okay. This entire derivation is given there. So you would get, so from this, we can see that the CV is basically KB squared temperature D times EF. Okay, I'll tell you how this comes about. Okay, integral over minus EF by KBT to infinity DX X squared times E to the power X divided by E to the power X plus 1 whole squared. Okay, so how does this come about? So what I can do is, again, when I take the derivative, remember I get a E minus mu whole squared. Okay, so the e to the power e minus mu by kbt, if I substitute this as x, then for e equal to 0, I will get a minus mu by kbt. Okay, and mu is ef, so I have substituted in the lower limit minus ef by kbt, already infinity. But then, because this is the highly peaked function at mu, it will pick out, it will become a delta function at ef, and hence the d of e can be pulled out of this integral, and only the density of states at the Fermi level contributes. This temperature come here. So remember, we are doing a E minus mu by KBT, right? So here also there will be a substitution, E minus mu by KBT. And that's what will give us, when we take that, when we take the derivative, this du by dt, that's when we will get a linear term in the temperature. This is what gives us, and this is just a number. Okay, so because for temperatures which are much smaller compared to the Fermi energy, this number is going to be extremely, extremely large, but there is a minus sign, so this can be taken to be minus infinity, and this is a standard integral which is independent of temperature. So this is exactly the same kind of trick that we had done for phonons also. Okay, and then this becomes, the result becomes basically pi squared by 3 kb squared t times d of EF. Formal result, but the formal result basically tells us that the density of states at the Fermi level is most important, because that's where the electrons are participating in absorbing the heat. Okay, and this T, we know where it is coming from. This T is coming from the width of the derivative of the Fermi function, because only the states within KBT of the Fermi level are able to absorb the heat. Okay, so this is what gives us that the CV is proportional to the temperature, and not only that, if you find the specific heat capacity as a function of temperature and look at the slope, then that slope gives you information of the density of states of the electrons at the Fermi level. Okay, so, and remember, the density of states at the Fermi level is in fact inversely proportional to the effective mass. Sorry, it's proportional. Okay, so that effective mass can actually be figured out by looking at the C by T ratio. Okay. So if you measure experimentally the C by T ratio, then this gives you information of the effective mass of the system, right? And Right. So are there any doubts so far?
No.
Sorry, so I've done this algebra that? Very sloppily, and if you want me to do the algebra very properly, then I'm sitting for this. Let me know. If some people want to follow this algebra very carefully and step by step, please let me know. And I can give you a formal derivation of how this Fermi function becomes a delta function also. I mean the derivative. But let's not do it in the class because this is basically algebra. And the physical points, you know, they get hidden if we go too much into the algebra. Apart from the algebra, is the physical argument clear? Are the steps clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, what about yes, that limit that minus epsilon?
This one, this lower limit?
Yeah, that one.
Right, you're talking about the, what we have done is we have taken x is equal to e minus mu by kbt, right? It to be exactly EF itself. Okay.
Okay.
So when the lower limit E is 0 here, the X becomes minus mu by kBT and mu is just EF.
Okay. Okay.
Is that okay?
So, so that will not
come. See, the other thing is that
any temperature dependent.
Correct. See, the EF by kBT for temperatures which are much smaller than the, let's say, even room temperature, okay? So this would be of the order of 10 to the power 3. And at 10 to the power 3, if I substitute into this expression, you can see that there is going to be an exponential decrease. And x is of the order of 10 to the power 3, right? Then you can see that e to the power 1000, this will be squared. So you will get an e to the power minus 1000. Basically kill this x squared, and any contribution coming from large and negative values will not really contribute. So basically then this can be taken to be minus infinity. This is no different from minus infinity. What we mean is that we can extend that integral all the way from minus EF by kBT or minus 1000, let's say, to minus infinity, and that extra contribution that we have added does not change any qualitative physics. Is that okay?
Oh, yeah. This fine.
Okay.
That formal derivation is there in the book Heibeck and Loop.
No, again, see the formal derivation is independent of the temperature, and ideally, what one has to do is there is something called a Sommerfeld expansion. Okay. And if you do the Sommerfeld expansion, you can do this completely properly and also take into account the temperature dependence of the chemical potential. Okay. So if you do that, then you can derive all of this in a very formal and exact way. Okay. And if I get enough emails about that, so please let me know if you want to see the derivation, separate sitting for that. Okay, based on our mutual convenience, whenever it's convenient, maybe on Tuesday or Friday, for example, in the coming week, we can do a full sitting and do the formal derivation. Just let me know.
Okay.
Okay. So, see, for the finite temperature properties, like for phonons also, we did the specific heat. And then I said that we will do the transport property for electrons and phonons when we do the Boltzmann transport formalism. Okay, so in the next class, what we will do is we will bring back the periodic potential in considering electrons without the periodic potential. When we bring back the periodic potential, we will look at the system again at 0 Kelvin and then solve an exactly solvable model of electrons which are moving in a periodic potential. That exactly solvable model is called the Kronig-Penney model. Okay, and when we do that exactly solvable model, we will see how bands arise. Okay, and that will give us a very good idea of why this periodic potential splits up the continuum of the energy levels into various bands. But that will be in the next class. So we are done now.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes, yes, go ahead.
Swamitaji asked about the specific heat of electrons and phonons. So I was left out at that time. So basically, the specific heat contribution due to the electrons is increasing at any as we increase the temperature. But the point is that the phonon contribution is very small at low temperature. And as we theta d is very small than that of the perfect temperature. So when we increase the temperature a small amount, then the electron contribution is not very changed, but the phonon contribution is drastically increased. That is why the electron is not dominant. Phonon is dominant.
That's absolutely correct. Yeah. So basically, we are saying that as you cross the Debye temperature, all of the acoustic phonons will start absorbing the heat. Okay. But you cannot even reach the Fermi temperature. So there will always be only a very small fraction of the electrons which will absorb the heat. Reasonable temperature, the electronic contribution is not going to be as the at any higher temperature, at temperatures of the order of the room temperature. Contribution due to electrons is definitely going to be much smaller. Okay. But
electrons contribution are increasing, but not in so much.
That's correct. But then, if you go to very low temperatures, the temperature contribution of the electron linear, terms is cubic, and the cubic function is a smaller function, right? So there will always be a neighborhood, not the specific heat contribution due to electrons. Then it is increasing linearly. Okay, linearly. But then what we are seeing is that for phonons, it's cubic to begin with. Temperature, it should cross this, and it should cross and become a very high value. Okay, drawn in a bad way. Go to temperatures which are of the order of 300 to 400 Kelvin, effects which come into the play. Okay, and then this kind of a linear contribution is not exactly valid. Okay, you have to consider other processes also. So, but yes, there is a crossover. The phonon contribution is much less at low temperatures, and as you cross the Debye scale or as you reach the Debye scale, the phonons will take over and they will have a much higher contribution than the electrons.
So at very high temperature, the electronic contribution is not linear.
Yeah, so it's actually not linear, because see, the thing is, the linear contribution we got because we took the chemical potential also to be independent of temperature.
Okay? Yes.
Go to very high temperatures, then remember that integral also had a minus EF by KBT. Right? Oh. So this okay. EF by KBT is not going to be minus infinity. Going to be a smaller number. So for example, if you are at let's say 10 to the power 4 Kelvin, which will never be, I mean, at 10 to the power 4 Kelvin, this is not going to be valid. So the metal is not going to remain a metal, right? It will melt completely. But if you could be, then the EF by KBT will be 10 to the power 5 by 10 to the power 4, which is of the order of 10. And then the temperature contribution will not be linear. You can ask, so this leads us to a small digression, okay? Can there be systems where the EF is much smaller than 10 to the power 5 Kelvin? Can I design a system where the EF is, let's say, 10 Kelvin? Not 10 to the power 5 Kelvin, but 10 Kelvin. Can I have a system like this?
It's a semiconducting system.
Semiconducting systems also have a very high chemical potential. If you take any bulk system, Fermi energies which are extremely, extremely large. Why did you say semiconducting systems? Tell me.
Because in P-type semiconductor, the EF is at below, close to valence band. That's why.
Say that again. Sorry, in P-type?
In P-type semiconductor, the Fermi energy, Fermi level is close to the valence band.
Yeah. So basically, you're saying when you dope the holes, So the valence band is somewhere here, let's say, and there is an impurity band, right? And which is where the dopants are. So this is where the Fermi level is, correct?
Yes.
But see, remember, there is always a reference value based on which you find the Fermi level, okay? And there the Fermi energy is not very small, actually. See, what we are looking for here is a very small density of electrons. Remember, the EF was proportional to n to the power 2 by 3, right?
Sir?
Yes.
Yeah. Sir, if the density of electron is very, very small, then we cannot discard the electron-electron interaction or something like that. So how can we derive that into the
part? Okay. So very good question. See, actually, the Wigner crystal part that I told you about, when the electron density is very small and you get a Wigner crystal, is a very different kind of a system. You have to have a pure electron gas where the electron-electron interactions are not screened. Okay. Normally, in a metal, for example, the electron-electron interactions are screened, and you cannot even deplete the electrons there. But there are other kinds of systems where you can use gate voltage, or you can use other kinds of systems where you can decrease the number of electrons. And that change in the number of electrons can give rise to the Wigner crystal kind of a form. For example, you can take a MOSFET, okay, metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor, where in between the dielectric and the semiconducting channel, by applying a gate voltage, you can form a 2D electron gas. Okay, and that 2D electron gas will have a minimum effect of the underlying lattice. It's basically an electron gas. And in that electron gas, the screening effects are really minimal, and you can also control the electron density very carefully. Okay, so there you can actually see, in fact, nobody has actually directly observed a Wigner crystal so far. So the conditions for observing the Wigner crystal are also not very easy to achieve. Okay, but what I'm talking about is, can we find a system where you can have a full lattice, you can have the ions also sitting somewhere in the crystal, but still the electron density is very, very small. Okay, so I will give you a hint. Okay, think about quantum dots, right? And next time when we meet, do let me know, how can quantum dots have a Fermi level which is extremely, extremely small? Okay, now quantum dots can be of varying sizes. Okay, we are not talking about very, very small quantum dots. We are not talking about, like, you know, 1 nanometer quantum dots, but something like 10 to 100 nanometer. Okay, if I take a 10 to 100 nanometer, say, gold nanodot, okay, then in that I can argue that the Fermi energy has to be very, very small. So,
sir?
Yes.
Sir, if quantum dots will require a delta function potential, then if we apply the potential, then how can we say that the density is very, very small?
Wait, where is the delta function potential? Sorry.
Sir, if we use a delta function potential in negative bound potential, then we can have a very small energy which is a bound state. Then we can derive, we can follow that. I'm just asking, I'm not saying.
Oh, no. So the thing is, for the quantum dots, there is a confining potential, but that's just the surface. We are not applying any delta function potential. See, we are basically applying the model of 3D electrons in a box, okay, and that box is basically the surface of the quantum dot itself. Thing is, just think about this system, okay, and next time when you think about it, apply the model of free electrons inside a box, and then tell me what would be the Fermi energy of such a quantum dot. Think, okay, because if you take a very small quantum dot, you will only get discrete levels, so you can't apply continuum. If you take a very large quantum dot, it will be like the bulk system. there is a regime which is in between the two. Okay, that's called a mesoscopic regime. And in fact, this is sub-mesoscopic regime. In the sub-mesoscopic regime, you can still think of the energy levels in a continuum and define a Fermi energy. Okay, so this is one system. Also, I would urge you to look up another system which is called ultra-cold atoms. So there are these, there is a system of ultra-cold atoms. Basically, you can take lithium, rubidium and so on and cool them down to extremely, extremely low temperatures. Okay, people have gone down to 10 to the power minus 9 Kelvin. Not exist anywhere in the universe except in the labs which have achieved those kind of temperatures. Okay, 1 nano Kelvin. So at those temperatures, what you can do is you can trap the atoms in an optical trap. Okay, and cool them down, and if they are bosons, you can get a Bose condensate, and if they are fermions, then either they will pair up, but there are some atoms which don't even condense. Okay, they don't pair up and they don't condense, and that's the Fermi gas. That's a detail. I will ask you, what did you get the Fermi energy for quantum dots and how did you get it, and for ultra cold atoms, what is the Fermi energy? Okay, so do come prepared in the next class. It's already 5:30 now, so let's close this. And yeah. Any question?
Hello?
Yes.
Sir, in fermionic condensate, you said that two fermion forms a pair and then it goes to condensation. Then when fermion itself is pairing, then it is itself a bosons. Then why we calling it as a fermionic condensate, not DC?
Okay. See, there are... it's not exactly a BC, right? Because the fermions, when they condense and they give you, for example, Cooper pairs. Okay. Now, a Cooper pair is not a local object in the same sense as that of a boson. For example, if you take rubidium atoms, okay, rubidium atoms can be shown to be bosons. They have a, they don't have integral spin, they have an integral spin. Rubidium atoms. And take it down to very low temperatures, you can see Bose-Einstein condensation of the rubidium atoms. But if you take at the same level, say helium-3 atoms, okay, helium-3 versus helium-4. Helium-4 is actually a boson, whereas helium-3 is actually a fermion. Now, what people have tried is, if you take the helium-3 down to lower and lower temperatures, can we actually get a pairing of helium-3? Okay, and as far as I know, that has still not happened. Okay, but there are other systems which where I believe the fermions have been paired up, and there you can get something like a superfluid. Okay, which is basically or a superconductor, which is a Bose-Einstein condensate of the pair of the fermions. But the pair of fermions is not exactly a boson. That again you can show, because it's not that when you take these two electrons which form a Cooper pair, they are not in one single place. They are actually quite delocalized, and there is a certain coherence length over which these two electrons are distributed. So all I'm saying is that you can't call it a pure Bose-Einstein condensate. You should call it a paired fermion condensate or something like that. But you can see that when you go through this ultra-cold atom literature, you will actually see what they call it. Okay, that depends on the literature as well, and how historically people have used the terminology. Have developed. But do read the literature, okay, and then next time come back to me and tell me how the Fermi energy, which in normal metals is of the order of 10 to the power 5 Kelvin, in these two systems, in quantum dots and in ultra cold atoms, can be an extremely, extremely small number. Atoms, you can get 10 to the power minus 6 Kelvin as the Fermi energy, 1 micro Kelvin, or even lower. Okay. Thank you, everyone. Bye.
Sir,
yes.
Hello. Yeah, when can the videos be uploaded? Like the previous classes, there was some network issue, so I couldn't follow.
Actually, see, the thing is, see, Saptarishi has been recording and I am trying to do some cropping and trimming so that the frame is captured nicely and also the initial few parts are removed. So, the thing is, lectures 2 to 5, I have been able to do the cropping and trimming, and already Saptarishi has uploaded some of the lectures. So he has also shared with me some of the other lectures. I will also be modifying that, and hopefully by Monday everything will be up.
Okay.
Saptarishi, is that possible? Okay, fine. Yeah. So the thing is, as soon as you share with me, okay, I will. So you have already shared some of the videos with me. So I will trim and crop those also, and then share those also with you. Then you can upload those also to the YouTube. Okay. Okay, then. Yeah.
Sir,
yes.
You were talking about some midterm exam. So, may I know the approximate date